Hi, welcome to this week's episode of The Shtick, where we're zooming in to Parliament House in Melbourne to David Southwick, Member of Parliament, and he's going to speak to us about what's going on in that great big house that we don't know really what's going on in there, except he does. Hi, David.
G'day, Henry, and it is absolutely live. You can hear bells probably in the background, and when those bells ring, that means we're meant to go in and vote. Thankfully, it's the red colour, which is the upper house, so I'm with you at the moment, but if it was the green bells, that would mean I'd have to leave and vote. So it's real time. Today is the first day that we've come back to Parliament since being 112 days in lockdown. So people are a lot happier, the fact that we're reopening Melbourne and people are able to get out and about. And of course, tonight, many of those small businesses that have been lockdown for now 112 days will be able to reopen. And I know that there's huge adulation amongst many of those small businesses locally that just can't wait to get themselves open again.
Yeah, it's the end of stage four restrictions, is that right?
Yeah, so it's been a number of changes, including the four reasons to leave home. So they're now gone. The ability to also... announcement was made by the Premier today in which you can, two people can visit somebody's home. So that's an additional change. Again, many small businesses are allowed to open. The 25 kilometre zone still applies until the 8th of November. So that will be a big change when the 25 kilometres is gone, because it will mean that particularly a lot of small businesses that need people to travel to them, they'll leave that 25 kilometre zone gone. So yeah, a lot of changes. I mean, I know a lot of people have really struggled, and I just wanted to give a big shout out to all of our locals in my area and your area, Henry, and Caulfield and surrounds, and made huge sacrifices. They've done it really tough. A lot of families, a lot of kids having to homeschool. And I know particularly mental wellness has been a huge issue. The fact that, again, one of the changes has been that we're able to resume community sport. So again, a lot of kids have not been able to play community sport. A lot of the footy and basketball and all the stuff that we're used to just hasn't happened. So kids have been stuck at home, families have been locked up, and the best thing ever is to be able to get out of lockdown and to be able to resume life as kind of normal, even though we still have a lot of restrictions around us.
Yeah, so we've got another 2 weeks now until November the 8th, and then there's going to be a whole new set of rules coming in.
Yeah, look, there will be. And then there's obviously lots of other changes. So I was talking to a lot of people from the sporting fraternity. I had conversations with the likes of the head of Cricket Australia last night. And I asked them about, say, the Boxing Day test. Now, Boxing Day test, they have 100,000 people in the MCG. And I said, well, you know, what's it going to look like come this Boxing Day? And he said they're hoping for crowds of still up to 50,000 people. So they're looking that they can still get big crowds in the MCG for Boxing Day. Obviously, we've got to go a fair way, because at the moment, with the current restrictions, you can have a maximum of 50 outdoors. So it's a big way to go before we can get to the likes of 50,000. But yeah, I mean, a long way to go. Obviously, the other thing is travel. People are dying to be able to get out and about, and that will need to happen. Borders will need to open. And Victoria is the slowest to come out of a lot of this. You saw a lot of the footy and the rugby, and of course the Vixens won the netball all over the weekend. The Vixens had 3,000 people playing in Brisbane. The footy had 60,000 people at the NRL and the AFL. So for Victoria to only be able to have 10 people attend a funeral, it's a big difference between only 10 at a funeral, but 40,000 can go to a footy game.
I know there was a lot of controversy with Dan Andrews' tough restrictions. I mean, there were people really vilifying him in a big way, as well as the protests that were happening. There have been quite a few protests, and I see there's another one coming up on Melbourne Cup Day. And you are the opposition member in Parliament in regard to your portfolio of police minister. What do you think about the actions or the toughness of the police in the circumstances of the protests?
Look, I think police have been put in a really tough situation of enforcing the lockdown to the extent that they have had. And one of the issues that certainly I think many people have seen on their TVs and what have you is when you've got pregnant women that have been handcuffed and taken away, a couple of little old ladies on a park bench that have been videoing something on their phone and their phone being confiscated. There's been lots of scenarios, a person that was run over in a police car. Certainly people need to obey the laws, but I think there has been issues in which police have effectively locked down at all costs. And I know I've been contacted by a lot of people with that confidence in police probably has been severely damaged by that. And I've spoken to the police commissioner about, you know, what needs to be done in building the reputation. I mean, Victoria Police do a huge job on the front line, and I think there'll be a lot of work needed to be done to rebuild that. There has been a lot of contradictions with what's been going on. The fact that we're allowed to have 10,000 people at a Black Lives Matter protest in March and not one person got fined, and yet we're seeing, you know, the likes of fines and arrests that we've had more recently. So again, I think confusion, contradiction. The Assistant Police Commissioner came out last week and said people are now allowed to protest, and then within 24 hours, the Premier said people can't protest. So there is contradiction and confusion. Certainly, it's my understanding people are allowed to protest. I think things need to be done safely. I certainly am not advocating for people to go out and protest during these times. You know, I'm certainly one that suggests that we need to follow the rules and have consistency. But, you know, I say this, Henry, you know, it's a tough job for any government to be able to implement what's being done. And I understand that. And I understand that we've needed to be able to get on top of the COVID situation, and we've needed to have certainly rules in place. But one of the things, and I know the Premier was celebrating with a whiskey and donuts last night that we've come out of lockdown, and a lot of people have patted, you know, Daniel Andrews on the back. But I'd say this, and that is we should have never, ever been in lockdown in the first place. Mm. That second wave, we should have never had that second wave that caused 780 people lives to be lost through that bungled hotel quarantine process. If it was 780 people that got killed in a train accident, then there would be literally people riding in the streets. So I don't care what age those people were. The fact that we've lost those lives, there needs to be government held to account. So yes, we've got to get on with things. We've got to be able to rebuild. We've got to restore confidence. We've got to reopen. But also, I really believe the government needs to be held to account for what's probably the biggest policy failure in Victoria's history.
Yes, it has been very contradictory, and there's been so much controversy through the whole thing about when we should open, what we should do. And even now, I think Dan Andrews has really taken an overcautious. He's really done the nanny state to death, as far as I'm concerned. But I appreciate that we do need to look at the health issue first. That's where the whole contradiction was, that weighing up health against the economy.
Yeah, look, the one thing about this, unfortunately, is it's divided people terribly. You know, the fact that you've got some people that just want to get out and get on with things, and you've got others that are a bit like, you know, Mrs. Peabody peering over your fence and dobbing you in if you've done something wrong. And I think it just, like everything, needs a balance. We saw an unfortunate situation in Moorabbin. Acro Bar, a cafe, that put a sign up on his cafe to say, if you're a Dan Andrews supporter, I'm going to charge you an extra dollar. And he was having a bit of fun with that. He had death threats and had a situation where he had to hire private security. And police said to him that he had to take down the sign because the sign was inciting violence. Yep. So in a state where we celebrate democracy and freedoms, I think we need to have rules that apply for all. And I think it's very, very unfortunate that we've got to a situation where people can't express themselves freely. And whether you're a Dan supporter or you're not, you should be able to have the ability to be able to say what you feel and express your views.
You've also been very proactive in sending emails. I've been getting emails from you very regularly with updates on the what's going on in the community. And I think that's a really great thing that you've done.
Yeah, look, we made initially over 3,000 calls when the COVID first outbreak hit to the vulnerable in our community, particularly the elderly, ensuring just a check-in to make sure they're okay. We've followed that up with probably another 4,000 or 5,000 calls since. So we've called a lot of people just to making sure they're okay. We've put out a lot of emails. We helped with distributing face masks through Tony Lotsov from Leashit, who provided a whole lot of masks. And we had volunteers distributing those masks right throughout the area, dropping them off to people's homes that, again, couldn't afford it or couldn't get masks. And we've helped with food programs with C-Care, Mazon, who provide food, soup boxes. So we've helped Mazon. And we did a great program when we had the commission flats in North Melbourne that were locked down. Mazon worked with me in delivering some soup bags to the Muslim community, and that was fantastic. And also a young guy, Benji, who runs Socks for Support, who's donated some 5,000 pairs of socks to people that are in need of socks. He has delivered a whole lot of socks to those commission flats in North Melbourne as well. So a lot of charity, and again, a big shout out to all of those not-for-profit community organisations, people that have helped during these really difficult times. And it really does show that through adversity comes strength and comes people that stand up and really help out. And I know that you've been a big advocate for Mitzvah Day, and that's coming up. And it's probably the best timing, because I think Mitzvah Day really should be every day, although we do have the time where we completely celebrate it and demonstrate how important it is. But during this time especially, Henry, during the 112 days of lockdown, people have really needed help, absolutely needed help. There's been huge exposure, again, in terms of people's mental health and wellness. And thank you to those people that have stood up and helped those that have really needed it during these times.
Yeah, speaking of Mitzvah Day, it's coming up on November the 15th this year, and it's the 10th anniversary. I remember in the early days, you commissioned me to come with you and the kids, and we had a lot of fun going to St Kilda Shul and down to Father Bob's, and it was so important. And also we went to the blood bank, which was really good. You're a very regular blood contributor, I remember.
Yeah, and I hate giving blood. I hate injections, not giving blood, but I hate needles. So the fact of having to put that in my arm, but, you know, it's very, very important to do that. The other thing too is it's the only time where you'll see me wearing a green T-shirt is during Mitzvah Day. Very proudly put the green T-shirt on for Mitzvah Day. And 10 years, it's amazing. I can't believe it's gone so fast. Yep. And as you say, you know, we've covered it for years now, going around together and highlighting just the great deeds that are being done in our community. And, you know, well done to those people that have been involved. Judy Fagelin, who kicked it off initially, and all of her team that have just been unbelievable in keeping such a good idea going and ensuring that community organisations are really profiled during this time. Because as I say, there are community groups that are doing work all year round, but I think what Mitzvah Day allows us to do is to showcase the great work that he's done all year round during a highlighted time as we do during Mitzvah Day.
And one last thing before we go, you've got a shofar there, which you mentioned, I think on Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, especially on Yom Kippur, I think, tell us what you did with the Rabbinical Council.
Look, we're in Parliament and it tends to be quite adversarial. There's shouting and screaming in the Parliament. But I wanted to particularly say that during the high holiday period, I had a great opportunity with working with the Rabbinical Council of Victoria, and I wanted to thank them and also the government. I organised to get into through the Premier's office to speak with them and Josh Burns, the federal member, and myself. We worked to ensure that we could get the shofar blowing right through the streets of Melbourne and ensure that we could do that in a COVID safe way. So it was done in a bipartisan manner to ensure that the government could mean that we could deliver that. And we also worked through a number of things. I had a meeting with the Rabbinical Council and Premier's office again today to look at religious events going forward and how we're able to do that. And so I just wanted to say that, you know, there are times where we do work together and we do get results. And I know particularly for those of faith that have found it really, really difficult to be able to go to shul where you can't have a minion of 10, that people have been able to have to survive without doing that. But thanks to the Rabbinical Council that have worked very, very closely with us to get things like the shofar done and also to get some minyans happening during the high holiday period.
Wonderful, yes, because I noticed that you can get in a synagogue or a church or a mosque, you can actually get 10 people in there with the minister on top of that.
Yeah, so the changes also that apply from now is 10 people indoors, plus yeah. obviously a rabbi or a minister, and 20 people outdoors. And if you've got a synagogue or a church that has multiple campuses on the one site, then that would mean that there would be more people that would be allowed to operate. So we've got obviously some of those sites like Yeshiva Beth Rivka and Mizrahi and others that would have multiple synagogues on a campus. So that would give them more numbers. But of course, they've got a distance, they've got to operate with a COVID safe plan, and safety is paramount. But, you know, religion is very important during these times, and faith for many is absolutely paramount. And I'm glad that we're able to get that stuff back on the agenda and people are able to practice their religions in a COVID safe manner.
Well, David, it's been really great to speak to you. Thank you for your time. I haven't Zoomed into Parliament House before, but we've only been able to Zoom in the last 7 or 8 months almost, where every episode has been on Zoom. And we're getting quite used to it. I think it's going to become de rigueur from now on, where we don't have to get you to schlep into my studio. I can go into your office or home, and it's fantastic.
Yeah, it's been one of the good benefits of all of this is the fact that we are using technology. I do miss the face-to-face, and I can't wait to have that kind of restored back into our lives. And I just wanted to finish as well by thanking you, Henry, what you do with the Shtick. It's a great community service, what you provide. You do really connect to all of us in our community in providing really important information about what's going on, and we appreciate that. And we should never, ever undervalue what you're able to do, particularly those in isolation, the fact that you provide current affairs, current events, and good stories, most importantly, that we all really celebrate. So thank you to you.
Yeah, we like to inform and entertain. I think that's the most important thing. And we're going to go to a young man now who is a real estate agent. His name is Golan Flam. And he's going to be talking to us about the current state of the real estate market, because everybody is interested in real estate, whether it be sales or rentals or investment, whatever it is, real estate is on everybody's lips. And hopefully we can spread some more good information about it.
Stay well, Henry, and best wishes to everyone out there.
Thank you so much, David. We'll be back after the break with Golan Flam.